Oh, wood sorrel.
Yeah! This is a really excellent one to learn if you haven't learned it already. How many of you are familiar with this plant? Aha! Wood sorrel. I want you to look at the shape of the leaf, how it's shaped a little bit like a heart instead of round like a clover. The leaves will be in clusters of three, and you're gonna have this yellow flower. And the seed pods have a banana-type shape to them. You can eat any part of the wood sorrel. You can eat the flowers, the stems, the seed pods are really, really good. It is a very sour flavor. Plantain, that's right. Okay, everybody find the biggest plantain leaf you can find. Bigger the better.
Where I'm from, they always called it white man's foot.
What? There you go. Because it would follow where the white man showed up. It was. It's an exotic species, not native to North America. That's right, and it's showing a nice seed head here. How many of you have ever taken Metamucil, the laxative? Mm-hmm. It's made from this. In fact, on some of the Metamucil bottles, you'll actually see pictures of the seed head. European variety. It's a beautiful flower. It has the petals hanging down, purplish color, color of her shirt there. But one of the really cool things about pale purple coneflower, it is a very powerful drug in the seed head here. When you take one or two of these seeds and chew on them in your mouth, it will make that part of your mouth go numb. And you'll get the tingling effect like when you go to the dentist and they give you a shot of Novocaine. Would anyone like to try this? Yeah, I will warn you, the effect lasts a fairly long time. So we'll just give you...
We haven't seen you eat it.
Oh, I did this once already this morning. But yeah, okay. So I'm only going to do one seed this time. I'm taking the husk and the seed. I'm going to keep it at that side of my mouth. And I'm only going to let you have one of each, too. Because I took two this morning, and it took a while for the numbness effect to wear off and the tingling. It's just very impressive. And I have heard of people who will chew on it, and then they'll put that on a sting or something else, and it's starting to already affect. That is really cool, because that is fast acting. It's just a little tingle that I'm starting to get right now in the side of my mouth.
You've probably heard the term echinacea. Take your echinacea. That's echinacea.
Yep. And they don't take it for painkiller. They use it for an immune system booster. So I have to find out.
Who's trying it? Who's trying it?
Right over here. Are you getting anything yet?
Oh, yeah.
I'll try it after I eat everything.
Oh, jeez.
Look on his face.
Oh. Oh, yeah. We'll let you. I think it's the seeds more than that. Okay. Don't take more than two, I would say. Because I'm just taking one husk and one seed, and I've gotten a good effect.
Yeah.
You
want it? Yeah, no, but I'm okay. I just want to see and see it too.
No, but it's worked out well for her.
Anyone else want to see what it looks like? A seed and stuff?
And so you eat, so you eat all of this.
Yeah, I would eat just, I took one seed and one husk. Yeah.
Okay, and this part?
That is the husk around the seed. The powerful part is probably in the seed itself right there.
Okay.
Now this is a plant you're going to find growing at this park a lot. This is very similar in its growth to a plant called hotness or ground nut. This one is called hog peanut or ground peanut. It produces little seed pods here that will produce a little edible bean. And the guy who talks about it says these aerial beans are actually harder to collect than a little ground bean that will actually grow underneath here. That you can dig up the plant and look for these little tubers that look like little beans. These guys, let's see if we can get any of these open. These are fairly immature pods, but you'll see the little nut inside there, little bean. This is an elderberry plant that was fully ripe about 2 weeks ago, and the birds and other animals have been eating on it. The berries have now dried up a whole lot. They've lost their juiciness. One of the ways you tell elderberry is by the compound leaf here, the very soft stems. The flowers and the berries will be in a flat cluster like that. Now, if you'd like, you can come on up here, grab a few berries, and try them out. They don't have a whole lot of flavor, a little bit of sweetness left in them right now. Elderberries, even when they're big and plump and juicy, don't have a whole lot of flavor. There is a caution with these plants because they have a hollow stem like this that's easy to push the pest out of. So there's young kids who used to make whistles out of the elderberry, but the elderberry wood here is actually poisonous. So when you're blowing on it or putting it up to your mouth, you can ingest some of the poison, and it actually made them a little bit sick. So berries and flowers are okay, but don't eat or lick other parts of the plant. Oh, good eye. I didn't notice the rosehips earlier. This is a multiflora vine. The thorns are not only sharp, they're recurved like a fishing hook. So they're designed to hold on to people pretty well.
And what rosehips are right here. Right here at the end of my finger.
Thank you. You can't believe how bad my eyesight is.
Here.
And like most of the roses, it has rose hips. And roses are in the apple family. If you get a really big rose hip, it'll often taste like a woody, dried up apple. But rose hips are loaded with vitamin C. And so if you don't like the flavor, you can just drop them into hot water to make a really healthy tea. Growing right here, we've got some violets, common violets, I hope, right at the edge of the timber. And I say I hope because there's also a woodland violet that likes to grow in the shade. Woodland violets will often have very fuzzy stems. Now, if you look at the stem here, you'll notice it's smooth, which is a sign of a common violet. And the main way you can tell is woodland violets are very bitter, whereas common violets are very bland and tasty. See, I'm just cleaning. Yes. I have learned.
Good job.
That's good. Okay. Who would like to try some violet? And the nice thing about violets, besides that it's very mild tasting, is it's loaded with vitamins. As you eat on these leaves, you're gonna get a huge dose of vitamin C, iron, B vitamins, D vitamins, and calcium. In fact, in the past, the pioneer folks would come out and eat on violets when they felt a cold coming on. Because these guys would come up early in the spring and they were so loaded with vitamins, it was like taking vitamin C tablets to help them fight off the cold. What do you guys think? Is that pretty mild?
Yeah.
Yes. It is great in salads. So imagine this mixed up with a little wood sorrel. Yeah. Now, there is, however, a drawback with the violets. About an hour after you pick this violet, if you leave it at room temperature, it develops an aftertaste when you eat it. So you have to keep them refrigerated. That seems sensible, right? It would be doable. Who would like to have the rest of that one? Your reaction to poison ivy because of the invisible oil that's on the poison ivy, leaves, stem, root, or vine. It'll show up maybe 2 to 3 days after you're exposed to yourself. If you get rid of that oil off your skin, you're gonna be okay. You can use rubbing alcohol. You can use a degreasing soap. But would you wanna use a soap with lotion in it? No, because that'll just spread it around. Bad idea. There's another way you can fight it too, and that's this plant right here. Yes, I heard someone else say it. Jewelweed. It's a jewel of a plant. And it's also called jewelweed because of the neat thing it will do with water spray. See if I can get it. Do it. Ah, you see how the water bounces off?
Mm-hmm. Huh.
Look at that. Oh, and look there. See how it sparkles? Like little diamonds. Oh, come on, guys. Go. Oh. I just love that. Okay.
It's hydrophobic.
Yes. So, the plant is a jewel of a plant because it will do the jewel thing, but it will also protect you from poison ivy. If
does
you can
flower,
get
this plant.
This plant.
But does it flower? Oh,
yes, it does. Yeah. Yes.
Should I find one for
you? Oh, yeah. Go ahead and look for a flower. If you can get some of the juice out, and this is a little bit easier to get. Can you see the juice coming out of my fingers? That juice will actually act as a barrier to poison ivy oil.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
So you have to put it on before you get into the poison ivy.
Yes. You do have to get it on you before you touch the poison ivy. Though some people say that if you break out with the blisters and you apply this juice to the blisters, it will help deactivate poison ivy oil on your skin. And I can tell you it gives you some relief to the itch. Ah.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's the one.
Very, very pretty. Hummingbirds also love those flowers and will utilize them a whole lot. I know, isn't that so nice? And look at how, what was it you were called? Clearweed? The leaves, reach out and feel the leaves here. Very, very softly, very, very nice. The leaves, the stems are almost translucent as well. Very, very nice. When it first comes up, it looks really stout and translucent, and it's really, really juicy. And it's like, it's, as it gets older and bigger, it gets kind of dried out and a little more rangy.
Like us.
Yeah! And you can eat this when you cook it. If you eat it raw, you can actually develop a tickle in the back of your throat. And then the last really fun thing are the seed pods. When this develops into a seed pod, they'll get swollen. And if you go up and you touch them very gently on a dry day, they will pop like that on you. And if you manage to find one and pick it without it popping, you can hold it in your hand, pop it, and then you can eat the seeds. And the seeds are very, very tasty. Right. So here's a little jewelweed plant, and dangling down right there is a pod. And it's a little bit translucent. You can almost see the two seeds inside of it. Does everyone see that pod? Okay, have you come forward? I want you to gently take that into your hand. No, you're going to cup it in your hand like this and then poke it. Go ahead and pull it off of there. And we're going to try and catch the seeds as they come out. It won't pop really fast. Oh, there it went. Yeah. Okay. Oh, we got brown seeds. Excellent. All right. Who would like to try? Oh, here, I'll take a seed. Go ahead and try one. And I personally prefer the green seeds. Ooh, good.
There was a lady who used to work for the park. She and her husband took care of Macoon Axis years ago. And they would harvest this in the fall.
Oh, right? Flavor.
And they would boil it down and they would put it in ice cube trays.
Ah.
And they kept it because they burnt wood. So in the winter when they were collecting wood and cutting wood, it inevitably got into some poison ivy. And then they would take those ice cubes and just rub it on the poison ivy.
That's what it's still giving. Do not touch this plant.
Yeah.
This plant is called stinking nettle. Notice how the flowers are right now and the opposite leaves and the grooves that you can see on the stems. But one of the best characteristics is look very close at the stem and under the leaf for tiny little hairs sticking out. Those are the hypodermic needles. If you brush against this plant, those hypodermic needles will inject a small amount of venom into your skin, and it is not a pleasant experience.
For hours.
Some people it will be hours, other people only 10 minutes. It is not fair. I mean, people react differently, and different plants have different amount of venom in them as well. Now, the nice thing about, notice I'm heralding it very carefully. The wonderful thing about nettle is it is actually a wonderful wild edible to eat. This guy is super high in protein. This time of year, he's not going to be tender enough to eat, even if I cook him well. But I could chop him up, put him in a pot, boil him, and then I can drink the tea broth. And I'll get a delicious, high-protein broth. In fact, how many of you have ancestors from Ireland? Really? Yeah, okay. Your parents! Your grandparents may have survived the Ireland potato famine by taking nettle soup and nettle tea. It's what a lot of the people in Ireland got by on. And on this side of the world, it is very useful because it has super tough fibers going through it. And these are a lot like how they make flax. The long fibers, grabbing it carefully here, can make very, and now I'm going to try and break some of those off. There. Take that and try, feel how tough that is.
Like fishing line.
You can make a really good rope. Oh, there, it got stung. Really good string from it. Who wants to try it? Anyone else? Anyone else? Yeah. Okay, take one without another. Oh, it's a really, really, and in fact, I heard someone say fishing line. You can use dog bane a lot for making fishing lines from this side of the world. But nettle is what they made lots and lots of string from. And you can see how long you could make off of this. The ideal time of year harvest is after the frost, because then the plant dies back and you can harvest without getting stung. Also, when you cook it, it takes away the stings. So in the early spring, this is a wonderful plant to eat. It's one of my husband's favorite greens to get to eat in the spring. This is a sumac plant. You'll see them with red seed heads like this. If you ever see one where the seeds are drooping down and they're kind of in clusters like grapes, avoid that because that's poison sumac. You can get a reaction from the leaves like you would from poison ivy. When they're red, sticking up like this, and in most places in Iowa, perfectly fine plant. And the sumac is really cool because these berries are coated with a nice sour flavor, a little oil. Now, to get back to the sumac. Yeah. Oh, feel the breeze. All right, so for the sumac, there's an oil that comes up on the outside of these berries when the sumac first turns red. Every time it rains, it washes away some of that oil, but it's very, very tangy. Would you hold that for me, please? So if you feel adventuresome, I'll have you hold that a sec. Hold that one. And this is ginger, and I'm trying to go down to get it ripped, hazel ripped. This is a very shallow rooted plant, and it's kind of fun. I'm gonna break it and scratch it, and will you take that and smell it and pass it around?
Yum.
Lots of people like to play with this. Mm-hmm. I haven't heard of people cooking it, but I have heard people boiling it in a sugar syrup to make candied ginger. Yeah, that's a nice mild, not near as hot and spicy as real ginger. It's not related to the ginger that you will buy in the grocery store, the real ginger, but that's a nice one. I like that. Okay. And you'll find that going out. Now
you could. I know that the pioneers did use it for flavoring food. They used it as a substitute for ginger, but I don't. You don't see a lot of people today who have.
No.
Yeah.
Yes, milkweed. And despite what Yul Gibbons says, many parts of the milkweed are actually edible. And I got into poison ivy without boiling. Because Yul Gibbons thought that the milkweed was really, really bitter. And he would tell you, well, you can eat the flower buds and you can eat the seed pods, but you have to put them in boiling water and change the water 3 times to get rid of the bitterness. And I've tried that, and it's like really bland afterwards, and it's a lot of work. But then Samuel Thayer tried it, and he actually found that the milkweed is actually a fairly sweet plant, and you could eat it raw, and you certainly didn't need to boil it a lot. I'm gonna taste to see, it's just really late in the season, but that's a really young leaf, so I'm gonna see how he's tasting. One of the characteristics of milkweed, you notice that white milky sap coming out, that latex, that gets a little bit sticky. Mm. Yep, not bitter. Who wants to try a little bit of milkweed leaf?
They're promoting for people to plant milkweeds to bring back the monarch. It's a big movement right now to get everybody to try and plant that.
And what I like to tell people is that if you plant milkweed for the butterflies, you're likely to do it because you got a good heart. But you could also plant the milkweed for food for yourself. Because when this first comes up, you can eat the shoot. When it gets a little bit taller, you can eat the top part. When it starts to flower, you can harvest the unopened flower bud and eat that. It's really good. That's one of my husband's favorite wild vegetables. And then afterwards, it's gonna form that little seed pod. You can harvest the small individual seed pods and eat those. Or you can wait till the seed pods are a little bit bigger and harvest the white fluffy stuff that's inside before the seeds turn brown, and you make what's called milk white out of that. It's kind of like a cheese substitute. Very tasty! Lots of food for people! So, I promote people, plant these for yourself and let the butterflies come and eat some too. And I hope that more and more people will plant more and more milkweed. Now the milkweed here, and there you see another one of it right there, have no seed pods on them, because I really wanted you guys to collect your own seed pods. But I have some back at the office that we're going to have you guys get to see. Yep, these are Highbush Cranberries. And looking at the leaf. Yes, these are Americans.
Let's see. So that's edible?
There's a...
Well, that's debatable.
Some people like, some people don't.
That's right. Now, I tried some earlier. I was not...
I don't know
not,
if you think it's maybe or maybe not. I'm
yeah.
Why is the maybe not?
This
well,
is...
They just don't.
I didn't like the flavor too much. I could eat them... Oh, here. Right there.
Well, I've had a really pleasant experience so far today. I don't want to spoil it.
Ooh.
That's pretty dang bitter.
One of the ways you can tell crab apples and other apples are ripe is looking at the seed. If the seed is brown, then that's ripe. If it's pale, not ripe yet. And even though these guys have the nice red flesh, that seed is looking pretty pale. So they could probably ripen up a little bit more, and that'll make the flavor better too. Now, if you want to, you can nibble on these a little bit, but these don't taste good. These do not taste good. You see that little bubble of sap?
If you can find some of that, and peel it off. If it's too mushy, it's not quite ready yet. This is a compass plant. And it has a resin. It gets off the stem. And you get some of that resin, and little Native American boys and girls and pioneer boys would eat it. Chew on it like chewing gum.
It's pretty tasty.
Can you find some over there on that one?
I've got a little one. I don't know if he's... It's probably too soft for harvesting. But if you come over, you can see this little white dab right there. Oh, you got rattlesnake master too. Can you see it in the axle right there?
Yeah, see that white.
Yeah.
Would anyone like to try this little bit? Oh, here. Here's some more up here.
It's better when it's hard. It's kind of like soft chewing gum versus chewing gum that's firm.
But you'll see this right here, this resin? You want to take a little bit of that? You can chew on it? Yeah, right there. Just kind of peel that off.
Oh, yeah.
Once it has kind of dried and then you chew it and rehydrate it. That's not the word I'm looking for. Rehydrate it. Then it has a real chewy, waxy texture to it. And you can chew on it for quite a long time.
Ooh, is that a thistle?
Making their nests and stuff. Yeah. We were just saying that, you know, we do have some invasive species that are thistle. But those, if you look at these, see how they're white underneath under the leaves? A lot of our native species are white underneath. Oh, so that's one thing you can look at.
So is that thistle, what's it called?
There's different kinds. Yeah, like sunflower. They all look alike to me. Thistle all look alike to me.
Look so
but
huge.
If you get that white underneath, you're probably looking at a native species and not a non-native one. The non-native ones are usually like the bull thistle and stuff, ones that you'd have to remove or try to remove.
And you can eat parts of the thistle. Before it flowers, as it's sending up that flower stalk, you can harvest it and peel that stalk, peeling off the outer rind, and then eat the inner core. In fact, the inner core of many flowering stalks are very tasty to eat.
And so now it would just be tough and stringy.
It would be tough and stringy and a little bitter because it's so far past the non-flowering stage.
And so when would you harvest that?
You would harvest it as it's starting to shoot up the flower stalk in the rapid growth. It would probably have been about 3 weeks ago.